be. We can do that, but the proposal, what the architects charged to do the master plan in '07 was $30,000 or $31,000.
Even the physical.
And that was 2007.
Right.
Yeah. So, but the task force is saying we should do another one.
Or update, that one.
Do you have to have the same people do the update?
No.
Or they just work off of what's already been done and they update it?
No.
Well.
They might start from scratch.
They have to start from scratch and you can't, that's not updating.
It depends who the architect is. The vision, every architect will have a different vision. So the architect that we select to look at the campus and look at the back will, it's be their vision.
Right, I think that.
We don't have to accept their vision, but that's the process.
We have to pay for it.
Right, that's the process.
And it won't be based on the document we have from 2007 at all?
Well, what I was gonna say is that the 2007 study did a pretty careful drawing of the building and the existing usage of it. However, the usage has changed in the children's room and a couple of other rooms. So there probably is a lot of work from the 2007 study that any architect can build on. And there's probably some that'll have to be done again that is different.
And also, since then, I think the.
Yeah, and then.
Some people on the FTF did an audit, you know, of the building. Sean and Joe and a few people did, you know, sort of brought up to date an audit of the building, and Amy had updated in terms of the services, the libraries, the programs.
Well, I wanna say that if you're gonna engage another architect for a master plan, that process has got to include all the outreach and all the focus groups that happened in 2007.
Right.
Because I felt confident that we could build the annex because it had a certain program. And I'm confident that the community was asking for that kind of program. But if we're looking at the whole campus and we don't talk to teens and non-users and Latinos and the fire department and everybody on the street, then it's meaningless. So it has to include that. You can't just update.
Exactly. A master plan process is maybe a year or a year and a half in duration, and it involves what Amy just described. It's not merely a pencil exercise.
You might remember that the woman from Saugerties pointed out that the architect that they hired engaged the community from the very beginning, that they had numerous charrettes, which and took account of what was said in those charrettes. So, I mean, that is a very, very useful process to get the community, and that gives a chance to take a temperature, as Doris was saying. What does the community think? And also, we'll see from how much actual community input we get there. If the community doesn't show up for it, then we'll know they're not interested.
So, you would like us to start from scratch?
I didn't say what I would like. What I said was that the woman who presented from Saugerties, I'll say it again, Jeffrey.
No, I heard what you say. This is what it said. I was under the impression
Listen to me, Jeffrey.
Yeah.
Was the woman who presented from Saugerties pointed out, let me say it once more so you get it. The woman who presented from Saugerties said that the architect started early involving the community, even before the design was finished, and they had community charrettes. That might have been helpful even in getting the bond passed, because the community had some ownership in the whole design. What we do, that's another whole issue. I'm just pointing out that they were here to give us the benefit of their experience.
This library, not the architect that we hired, but this library embraced the whole community. That's how I became a board member here, through a World Cafe. Okay? And that's how I got involved here. And I believe that was the outreach of the library to figure out what the community wanted. The community wanted some public space. The community wanted
technology.
The community wanted a makerspace. That was my impression.
That's what we found out when we were working on our current
five-year
plan.
This, I believe that this board has done its due diligence. I really do. And I still believe that this project across the street is a viable project. I'm still open-minded, but I'm not going to be open-minded until I hear somebody tell me that what we were proposing across the street has been looked at seriously.
So, any more discussion about this at this time? I invite and encourage all board members to come on December 2nd to the CAMO and engage in that conversation, listen to what we hear from the public, what the Facilities Task Force responds. This is a work in progress.
Yeah, and in addition, I mean, assuming that next week's Woodstock Times is going to have an article about this and, you know, announce the meeting with the press release, and Freeman will probably run it too. But will there be something on the library website or an email going out to all the library?
Yep, just like the last one.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
And maybe flyers.
So, are we ready to move on to the Planning Committee? Okay, I think we are.
I have no plan.
Okay. Public relations. Barry.
Hope, did everybody get the email I sent yesterday? Because it's taken us a long time to get the stuff up on. One of the reasons is all the time that's being taken up by Amy's doing foils. I mean, so I tried to put it up yesterday, and somehow or another, it ended up in some site up on YouTube. It's not on a page, but it's somewhere up there. But if you got the email, you were able to click on the link and go and see it. I don't know if there's going to be a show next month, because it's taken this long for this one to go up, and I haven't really even gotten started on videotaping. I'm going to do the first one tomorrow. If I can't get up the beginning of December, I'll keep working on something until I get something up there that will be promoting something we're doing. That's about it. I have nothing else.
Thanks, Barry. Next is the report from the Policy Committee. And I sent along with the agenda the draft ethics statement and the amended policy on public participation that we're going to consider. And Dorothea pointed out that I had left a typographical error in the ethics statement that we'll get to when we get to that part of the proposal. Is this just the ethics statement you're sending
around
now?
Yes, it's freezing.
Yeah.
Do you want them both right now?
No, let's do them one at a time. Is that okay with you, Policy Committee?
Thank you.
Okay. You're the Policy Committee here for the moment. Elaine, keep your coats here, so she'll be back in a moment.
I've been freezing all night.
I have my coat on.
So, you want to explain what we did, or
do you want to explain? I don't know.
Sure. This is the same ethics, Board of Trustees ethics statement as we looked at in October, with the following changes. The changes that are have a line through them are proposed to be crossed out, and the changes that have highlighting, in the case of what was just handed out, it's gray highlighting.
Did the extras go to the public?
No.
Is what Thanks. The Policies Committee proposes to add. The two issues that seem to be we had the most conversation about was the one about supporting positions adopted by the board, and the other was how do you know what's a sufficient, how do you know that a trustee remains competent? And the Policy Committee proposed changing the language about once the board adopts a position to the one that you see here with the gray highlighter.
And the typo is in the second highlighted part. It should be, it says I commit to attaining, it should be by participating, ING.
Right. Thanks, Dorothea. Otherwise, it's the same as before, including the double question mark at the end of the one next to the bottom of the page. Which I propose that we take one of those out. Or no, conflict of interest policy on, we'll put in the right page in our policy.
Yes. Well, I like the restatement, the paragraph or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's, yes. More diplomatic. And so I think it's a good policy. I don't think I've added anything to it.
You see it's on the back too. Dorothea.
Yeah, I agree with Christina. The new paragraph, I'm like a million times more comfortable with that than what it used to be. You know, that one can distinguish between one's own views and those of the institution. And, you know, to me this sounds like something consistent with being a responsible board member and also, you know, freedom of speech.
Can I ask the public for some information?
Well, we really normally don't do public be heard after the public be heard.
I have nothing to say. It looks good to me, but I would be interested in John Ludwig's opinion. Seems
how about
to
if
have
we wait
interest.
And get it by email or however he delivers it at our next public be heard to be consistent with our system. And you heard Ken Panza's, I read Ken Panza's opinion earlier on, where if we, the bottom on the front page, I will comply with the open meetings law, and Ken observed that if you're complying with that law, why not comply with the freedom of information law? Interest, Elaine.
Well, it was my understanding that freedom of information, has to be filed and have access to documents. I don't think that any one member by themselves would have the right or the access to the records, and that's really the director's.
Yes, I agree. I think it's the institution that is subject to the freedom of information law, but not the individual.
Right, and
the board is involved with open meetings. That means
we
have
can come
meetings.
To a meeting, have boots on the ground, but the FOIL really has to be done by an official, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, just as a point of law, as individuals, as elected individuals, your documents as part of a board member are subject to freedom of information.
I actually didn't move fast enough to ask Ken to not address us at this part of the meeting. But everybody can ignore whatever they just heard if they want to. The issue is, are we ready to adopt this as an ethics statement? And Barry Samuels had something, and then Kathleen. Oh, I just saw your hand waving. Yeah. Kathleen, go ahead.
I'm going to accept this.
Okay. Is there a second? I heard Dorothea just before you. So it's moved by Kathleen and seconded by Dorothea that we adopt the Board of Trustees ethics statement as was presented to us tonight. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. Thank you, Policy Committee. And there's another policy which has to do with last spring. We amended our policy on public participation in board meetings, and this is a proposal to amend that policy. One of the issues that caused the policy committee to take a look at this was the question of whether the public be heard should be at the beginning of the meeting or at the end of the meeting. And this particular policy has it at the end of the meeting after new business, but that's a change that is subject to conversation by the board. The policy committee wasn't sure which would be the best.
Yes.
Well, I think that this meeting's going long enough myself.
Yeah.
And we should just do the policy stuff.
Yeah.
Again, oh, in this case, it's italic is what's added, and strikeout is what's removed, rather than highlighted for what's added.
Just trying to confuse us.
Well, I'm not trying to confuse you. Just that sometimes
it turns out
that I do one thing and sometimes another. Yeah,
no.
Oh, Jay, you're making it hard for me to keep the public into the public be heard part of the meeting. But as library liaison, you do have a special relationship to the library.
Uh-huh.
And so I would
go for it, Jay.
Entertain a brief comment from you
very
in that capacity.
My personal opinion on public be heard, and I've expressed this at the Woodstock Town Board, is that there be the opportunity at the beginning and at the end. That provides people with the ability to make a statement or a question about what has transpired during the beginning, during the meeting itself.
Thanks, Jay. Jesse.
I suppose any policy needs to be flexible enough to accommodate whatever situation we're facing. I mean, would it be possible, for example, to decide, depending on where we thought we were for that meeting, to put it at the beginning or at the end or both? Perhaps that could be just reported in the agenda. I mean, can we remain flexible enough to be able to accommodate whatever faces us?
At the beginning of every meeting, we approve the agenda, so it can be adjusted at the beginning of any meeting by agreement of the board.
So you're saying it's a policy,
so,
but...
No, I wanted to go on to say that, that having a policy means that the decisions about this aren't arbitrary and arbitrarily made at the beginning of each meeting or somewhere in the middle of each meeting, but that we would like to be consistent and like to inform our public how it normally works. And so that's the benefit of having a policy. And the policy can, of course, say that we decide at the beginning of every meeting when we're going to have the public be heard. Or it can say what Jay suggested. It can be beginning and end. And the policy, I think, is helpful so that everybody knows what to expect. That is to say, public who might be coming to our meeting. But what the policy says is up to us and could be what you suggested. Dorothea.
I think my concern if we, you know, if it was kind of, you know, just decided each meeting where to put it, I think if people want to come and comment, you know, that it's easier for the public if they know if that's going to happen at the beginning or at the end, or if it's going to be at both. I mean, it's not fair to people, you know, normally do it at the end and then say, oh, this week we're going to do it at the beginning. I mean, I think it should be a consistent thing.
Okay, are you done?
Yeah.
I saw Caroline and then Jesse. All right,
and
I saw Jesse and then...
I think my statement was misconstrued. I did not suggest that we decide at the beginning of each meeting when it was going to happen. I decided that we remain flexible. For example, it could be a part of a published agenda that was available well before we came to the meeting. I actually didn't suggest a framework in which it be implemented, but the point was that it's sometimes useful to remain flexible.
Thanks, Jesse. Caroline?
My concern about the public be heard coming after, at the end of the meeting, as we're calling it, is that it's less convenient for people because it's difficult to know exactly when that will be, whereas when the public be heard is at the beginning of the meeting, people have a pretty good sense of when that's going to take place, although they have no idea where they'll be in the queue and how many people will be there. But so that's all. Obviously, if someone has something they already want to say before the meeting, they're ready to say it at the beginning. If they're coming to the meetings and listening to the whole meeting and they want to say something about the meeting, at the end of it, it gives them that opportunity to do so. So, I'm not sure which. Anyway, that's all.
I'm hearing general concepts. I'd encourage us to start expressing opinions about what we think it should be. I saw Barry Samuels, then Barry Miller. But in order to move this along, if you have an opinion, let's...
I do.
Good. Yeah.
Okay. I agree with Jay Wink about having it in the beginning of the meeting and at the end. Then we won't have to deal with people interjecting during the meeting and preventing the process of our meetings going smoothly. They can have that opportunity at the end to talk about what we would have been talking about. Yeah.
Barry Miller, and then Jeff. Jeffrey?
My thoughts about that are, if something earth-shaking strikes somebody in the audience and wants to say something that takes place during the meeting, after public be heard at the beginning, can that be tabled for them by giving us a note or letting us know that they would like something discussed at the next meeting? So, because the way the public's been heard has come up is, if people start talking at the end of the meeting, we can be here until 11, 12 at night. And I would rather cut it off at, end at one point. I prefer the beginning, I think, than the end. And anything that happens during the meeting, and I think it's been happening by FOILs and other requests here, you hear something at the meeting and you want to find out about it, so you're coming and getting the information anyway. So I think that that needs to be tabled by the person who's in the audience to speak about it at the next meeting. I don't think it could be that earth-shattering that it can't wait.
Thanks, Barry. Jeffrey.
Well, I believe that this came up because the public be heard session of the meetings was becoming very disruptive to our meetings, and it was setting a tone for me that was very undesirable. And I would much prefer that we, as the board, we're here to do the library's business, that we take care of the library's business, and then listen to what the public has to say. And if they want to change the tone of the meeting at the end, that's much more desirable to me.
Thanks, Jeffrey. Elaine.
I'd like to support you in that sense, Jeffrey, that we are here to do the library's business. And sometimes I find it distracting that the public, the things expressed or the attitudes expressed or the lack of respect expressed colors my feeling about it. So maybe it would be better at the end if there could be a limit on it in the time. Then people would be able to comment on what they had seen and heard at the meeting, but we would still have gotten the business done. Doing it early, while it seems to make sense for people, they can come early and get it off their chest, but then if they wanted to talk again at the end, it's going to stretch our meetings out pretty long.
Thanks. And that gives me a nice opportunity to say there are other changes in here in this policy in italics besides just the when the public be heard. That was an issue for us to talk about. For example, you spoke of controlling the time, and this provides that the board president is responsible for such things.
And the tone.
Mm-hmm.
I like it.
I have I think I'm looking around and seeing that it's late. Is there anyone care to make a motion, either to accept this, to not accept it, or to send it back to the policy committee with suggestions?
I make a motion to accept it.
Okay. It's moved by Jeffrey to accept
Can
the...
Can I second?
Yeah, it's seconded by Elaine to accept the policy as presented?
Yes.
With the public be heard near the end of the agenda.
But with the flexibility that we can change that if we think that's... I mean, we can adjust that, right?
Yeah. I would like to address that.
Yes, in the way that I said, but go ahead, Jeffrey.
I think consistency is a good thing. I think it can be misconstrued, you know, if you allow some people to speak sometimes and other people not to speak other times, that could be misconstrued as being, you know, biased. Or,
well, I've been to other meetings that where it's to ask a question of that group or just given a general announcement, and they will say, you know, you can go first, just start off the meeting, do your thing, and then you can go because you don't really want to sit through the whole meeting. And that's a courtesy. So it sometimes, you know, I'm busy. I don't want to sit in somebody else's meeting that isn't my business, you know. It's like, they got a meeting, I don't want to sit there. I just want to say my thing and go. So if someone comes in and requests to speak to the board or a board, to give them that courtesy of going first, I don't see why we can't be that flexible.
Who's going to make that decision? And
well, the board would make the decision when it's setting the approving the agenda. But there's nothing in here about that. And if you're suggesting that there should be some way of making a written request to address the board, if we adopt this, so that the routine public be heard is at the end of the meeting. You could put something in that if a request was received up to an hour before the board meeting at the library, then the board could consider that when it's considering the agenda. That's a possible thing to say. That is the sort of thing it sounds as though you're asking, and it sounds like a way to get that request without having to wait for public be heard at the end to make the request.
Well, it feels like we're writing this huge policy over, it just seems really complicated and we're not very nimble when we have these policies that, I don't know, it just, I don't want to make it this big, huge to-do. It's Woodstock, crying out loud.
Well, everything, the board always has the possibility of overriding a policy or of doing what it wants, almost, except, of course, what the law, we have to follow the law.
Yeah.
And so our agenda belongs to the board, and that's why we talk about it first thing every meeting.
Is it possible to table this?
Yes, of course it's possible to table it.
I mean, after it was...
And
people wanted it decided tonight, but I think there's enough discussion that maybe we should think about the different options further.
Jeffrey had something to say,
this doesn't say that we can't let somebody speak. It just says this is our policy. But
this is the normal way it works.
And it's good for people to have some consistency.